Hello and welcome to this short overview about Bluetooth beacons. I'll tell you a bit about, well, first of all, what are Bluetooth beacons, then what's new with Bluetooth 5 and why Bluetooth 5 is so important for beacons. Afterwards, I'll go a bit into details about the different specifications, like what is an iBeacon, what is Eddystone from Google, and then as a bit of a practical example, I'll also show you how to capture the signal of Bluetooth beacons using an Arduino board. So we'll take a look at what kind of information is actually sent by the beacon. And at the end, I'll also give you a quick overview of how you can actually use Bluetooth beacons using Windows 10 and the Universal Beacon Library that I've been developing for Bluetooth beacons. My name is Andreas Jackel, and you can follow me on Twitter at Andy Jackel, and I also recently started my own blog at andreasjackel.com, where you can find a lot more information about Bluetooth beacons, about HoloLens, augmented reality, and a lot more of the other interesting topics. Okay, so let's first of all start with an overview of Bluetooth beacons, what they are and what you can do with them. So on the right side you can see, well, my phone, and on the left side one of the Bluetooth beacons. In this case it's a Bluetooth beacon from contact.io, and well, what does this Bluetooth beacon do? It actually always transmits small packets of data, for example the ID. So every Bluetooth beacon should have a unique ID so that you know what is what, and for example it can also transmit the transmission power or any kind of other information that you set. So this is always done continuously. You can imagine a Bluetooth beacon to be like a lighthouse in the sea, which always sends out information to say I'm here, and if a phone comes close to it, it can just get the data and do something with it. How far does a Bluetooth beacon go? Well, it's around 70 meters on average. Of course, it depends a bit on how much power you invest into the Bluetooth beacon. So some beacons allow you to configure the transmission power. And of course, the more power you use for transmitting the signal, the bigger the range, but of course, the shorter the battery life. So there's no back communication channels like a lighthouse. It sends out lights, but you don't really talk back to the lighthouse, right? I mean, also for Bluetooth beacons, they just tell you I'm here, or they transmit specific information. But it's not supposed to be in the way that the phone connects to the Bluetooth beacon and starts talking to it. It's just really the beacon for sending out information. And when your phone actually finds a Bluetooth beacon, it depends on the phone what you want to do. So for example, an iPhone could tell you, I found a beacon, it looks it up in the iTunes store, then it finds out, okay, this beacon ID is well relevant for this app, for example, from your favorite supermarket, and the iPhone would ask you, well, there's some content from the supermarket close by, do you want to download the app? If you already have the app installed, the phone would, for example, ask you to open the app, and then once your app is open, I mean, it's up to you what you want to do with the Bluetooth beacon that you found. So, for example, in a supermarket, you could know that you are close to this particular area of the supermarket where there's a special offer, and you can alert the user about this special offer that he could take advantage of. So you can alert the user about things that he otherwise wouldn't see. Another application area where Bluetooth beacons are really important is indoor navigation. So, well, the beacons have a limited range, so you know if you see the beacon that you're really close by to this area. And this allows you, if you have multiple beacons and you can triangulate the positions, if you know where each beacon should be and how strong is the signal that you receive, you can check where you are, even if you're in a building or in the cellar, for example, where usually no other signals go through too well. What's inside a beacon? If you just open this beacon, you see that it's not much. It's really tiny. I mean, there are bigger and smaller beacons, of course. So essentially, it's just a small Bluetooth chipset. So more or less just one big chip, which handles all the logic of the data and how to send it, and an antenna, of course. And then usually there's a rather big battery. So it depends, of course, on the Bluetooth beacon that you have and how you configure it, like how often it should send out the signal. Is it once per second? Is it 5 times per second? And also the transmission power. But on average, a Bluetooth beacon with a normal battery lasts between 1 to 4 years. So it is quite some time. It's always active, but it's really low power Bluetooth, so low energy Bluetooth. So this is why you don't really have to worry too much about the battery life, even though it's always active. Battery can last a really long time. So quite often now, Bluetooth beacons are positioned like as a killer for NFC, because NFC has been a hype quite some time ago, and then it's many people think it died, and Bluetooth beacons are a lot better than NFC. Well, that's not really true. So there are three areas which do have, of course, some overlap, but they all have the very specific use cases which only these technologies can do. So actually, in the real world, we couldn't live without any of those three. They are all very important. So first of all, of course, I mentioned the use case of navigation, of location using Bluetooth beacons. GPS, well, you know it, it's obviously the prime navigation technologies, so GPS is working pretty much worldwide, but only outdoors. So as soon as you are in a building, your phone cannot see the satellites anymore, so it will have a really tough time to find out where it is exactly. So GPS cannot be used for indoor navigation. Obviously, well, the satellites are in the sky, so it's also only in one direction, so your phone can't send a signal back to the GPS satellite. You can only receive the signals of the satellites and use this info to find out where you are. So this is also actually the main and pretty much the only use case. It's for localizing where you are in the world. Can be pretty accurate depending on who you are and what kind of access level you have to GPS or Galileo or whatever system. But yeah, essentially this is GPS. Bluetooth beacons, in comparison to GPS, they also work indoors. So essentially you can imagine Bluetooth beacons to be like tiny satellites that you put into your own apartment or your own company. They have a lot shorter range than a satellite. I said about 70 meter is the maximum. It's also only one directional, so usually the Bluetooth beacons only send out information, but they don't really listen to others. And their main use case is not localization, but providing proximity information, so that you can really say, okay, I'm close to this specific point in my supermarket. Or for example, you could say in a city, in a tourist use case, I just approached this really famous statue, and then your tourist guide app could say, ah, well, right now you're standing in front of the statue, and this is the background story about who made it and what it should present. And then, of course, the third technology, which is a little bit similar, is NFC. NFC, well, it also has a little bit of range, but essentially it's easier if you just say NFC is a contact technology, so you really need to tap something for the transaction to occur. The really big difference to beacons and GPS is that it's bidirectional, so you can actually talk back to the NFC card, and that's really important. Because most of the use cases around NFC, where it really got famous and where it's really useful, is actually payment, where your smart card, for example your credit card, has got NFC. You just hold it to the terminal, and then the terminal actually starts talking to your NFC card. So it sends it an encryption challenge, and the card will do its encryption magic and send back. And then in the end, after they have been sending information back and forth, the card will have authorized the payment to the terminal, and the terminal then instructs, for example, a MasterCard to perform the transaction. So it's really in two directions, and that's really important. So like an access use case where you have a key card for your office or for the hotel, this also only works with NFC, where you really have to get close to the door lock. You have to touch it, and it has to be bi-directional communication, and it has to be highly secure. So NFC is more like a trigger technology to initiate a payment, to initiate opening a door. It's not so much for knowing where you are. So this is just the main difference, and you see that there is actually very little overlap. All three technologies have got really important use cases, and depending on what you want to do, just choose what you need. Well, so let's talk about what's changing in the world of Bluetooth. Well, actually, recently, Bluetooth Low Energy or Bluetooth LE got really famous. So that's the low power variant of Bluetooth that every phone nowadays is equipped with, and like all your Bluetooth heart rate monitors or your fitness smartwatches usually have Bluetooth Low Energy, which is of course important so that the small batteries stay there long enough. Well, Bluetooth actually also tried to market this as Bluetooth Smart, but well, nobody really liked it and nobody used it, so Bluetooth Smart died as well, and everyone is using Bluetooth Low Energy. And now actually the news is that also Bluetooth Low Energy is dead. So instead of Bluetooth Low Energy, it's now just Bluetooth 5, because Bluetooth 5 is always low energy. You don't need a distinction anymore between normal Bluetooth and low energy Bluetooth. So what has been changing with Bluetooth 5? It's really important for beacons. Well, first of all, you get two times the bandwidth, so it's now up to 2 megabit per second without increased energy consumption. Of course, this is really important for Bluetooth beacons as well, because you can transmit the information quicker, which of course in turn also means that the Bluetooth beacon has to be active a shorter time. So to get the same amount of info, it only needs to be active half of the time with sending, and of course sending uses all the power. And then even more important is that Bluetooth 5 has got 4 times the range. So the aim is actually that with Bluetooth 5 you don't only have 70 meters, but you can do whole home wireless scenarios. So think of smart homes. Smart homes really have this very difficult situation right now about what kind of wireless technology should you use. And right now I myself am building a house, so I'm in the same situation, and it's really a bit painful right now. What do you use? What system components? Of course, many components use Wi-Fi in the smart home, but Wi-Fi is, well, it's a completely wrong technology in my opinion, because it uses far too much power, and you'll know if there are too many Wi-Fi devices, then the frequencies just are not enough. And if you imagine a real smart home where every switch on the wall is connected, where every lamp is connected, your home would be completely full with Wi-Fi devices and nothing would work anymore. Then of course there are also some other technologies like Zigbee, for example, but they all have their disadvantages. And Bluetooth Low Energy was also used by many devices, but it had a disadvantage of having a too short range, for example. And now with Bluetooth 5, well, they're positioning Bluetooth as the perfect technology for smart homes, because it uses very, very little energy in contrast to Wi-Fi. It actually also supports mesh networking, and you can have a lot bigger range so that it's no problem anymore to connect your light to some central hub or to the smartphone. Well, and then the last thing is 8 times the broadcasting message capacity. And actually finding out what this one means is a bit tricky. So they in the Bluetooth marketing materials, they just say, oh, it's so cool because it has got 8 times the message capacity. But if you want to find out what it actually means, you have to dig a lot deeper into the specifications to see the real difference. And you'll see it a bit later, but essentially for Bluetooth beacons, well, let's say it this way, this change is mainly here for Bluetooth beacons. So a Bluetooth beacon can only transmit a very, very limited amount of data. So every of those advertisement frames that it sends out several times per second so far could only be 31 bytes. And 31 bytes is a very, very limited amount of information. So if you want to send out a web URL, you really, really very quickly hit the limits of 31 bytes. So you can't really transmit a long web address in a Bluetooth beacon. And this, well, this capacity now increased 8 times. So instead of just 31 bytes, you can now have 255 bytes in each and every Bluetooth advertisement, which of course means for you that you can send a lot more data in the beacon in a single frame, like for example a longer web address of your website. So as said, Bluetooth 4 Low Energy is a feature within Bluetooth 5. Bluetooth 5 is backwards compatible, so if you already have a Bluetooth 4 low energy Bluetooth beacon or phone or smart home device, it will of course still work if you now get a Bluetooth 5 phone. So that's the good news. Bad news is if you really want to use Bluetooth 5 for the whole process to get all the benefits, both devices of course have to support Bluetooth 5. And well, it will just take a little bit of time until the whole ecosystem is updated to Bluetooth 5. The world's first phone that has Bluetooth 5 is the Samsung Galaxy S8. Well, a few others have been announced since then, but of course it will take a bit of time until also mid-range and cheap phones have got Bluetooth 5, and of course until there is a new generation of smart home devices and Bluetooth beacons that also use Bluetooth 5 instead of the old Bluetooth 4 low energy. And of course every presentation is only complete if you show some million numbers and use this to well, emphasize how important the technology is that you're talking about. So I've done a lot of NFC near field communication presentations before, and there were always those predictions about how NFC is going to skyrocket and go through the market in the near future. And well, let's do of course the same for Bluetooth. So these are statistics that are cited by the Bluetooth Special Interest Group. And well, what it predicts is the number of shipments in millions from 2016 to 2021. And of course, it's really, really huge numbers. But the really important thing is actually that you see that everything is growing and slowly growing. But the red part at the top is what we are interested in. These are the Bluetooth beacons. So in 2016, it will be around, or have been around 8 million Bluetooth beacons that have been shipped. And for 2021, they actually already predict 565 million Bluetooth beacons. So it's really a several 100% increase, which is quite amazing. I mean, how many times do you get the chance to work on a technology that's exploding so fast? And the other thing that goes up really quickly is the smart homes. That's the green one. Not as much as Bluetooth beacons, because of course you need a lot more Bluetooth beacons and they're a lot cheaper. So if you want to equip your warehouse with Bluetooth beacons, you need, well, maybe 200 of them. For a smartphone, you won't need so many devices usually, but it's still also growing very quickly. So now the next part is, what is actually behind the Bluetooth beacons? How do they work? What are the standards behind it? In this short overview, I just want to concentrate on the two main beacon formats. And one of them certainly is the iBeacon, which is for some people similar to Bluetooth beacons because it was the first one. The first standard, it's coming from Apple. And the second important standard is Eddystone, which was invented by Google. So first of all, the iBeacons. iBeacon is a proprietary specification by Apple. So you have to sign up to the developer, Apple developer. There's an agreement that you have to adhere to that well, limits what you can do with beacons and how they work and what you're allowed to do. And actually the Bluetooth beacons from Apple, the iBeacons, they use the 31 bytes that we have in Bluetooth low energy, they use this for transmitting a set of IDs. So an IP con always sends out three IDs. One is the usual ID, then a major and a minor ID. And these IDs are used by the iPhone to check which app belongs to this Bluetooth beacon. And then of course you can use, for example, a minor ID once you will the phone open your app, because it knows this beacon is yours, and you can use the minor ID to find out which beacon is it now exactly that belongs to you. So it's very simple format, but very efficient, of course. Well, disadvantage with proprietary specifications is, of course, that it's not so easy if you want to use the IPCon specification outside of the Apple world. Not everyone wants to or can just use the or sign the developer agreement from Apple. So this is why Google came up with another specification, which is actually an open beacon format. So it's under an open source license, and they call it Eddystone. You can find the complete specification on GitHub, and also, of course, a sample implementation from Google. And also Google made the format a lot more flexible. So right now, four different frame types are defined instead of just one for the IPCons. So one is quite similar to IPCon. It's the Eddystone UID, which just sends out the Bluetooth beacon ID and additionally also the transmission power level. Because for IPCons, actually, transmission power is fixed. It's regulated in the standard of Apple. But for Eddystone, you can choose what kind of transmission power you want to have. And of course, the phone needs to know the transmission power so it can use this one to calculate its distance. But Eddystone also has a lot more uses. For example, there is a telemetry frame where you can transmit the remaining battery level, which is important if you want to know how long your beacon will still survive until you have to replace the battery, which is not so easy if you have got 100 beacons on the ceiling. You can't just go there and measure the battery and put it back again if it's full, so you want to minimize this. And also very important is the Eddystone URL frame. So Eddystone URL is just transmitting a web address, and the cool thing about this is that you don't need an app for it. So if you have a recent phone with Google Chrome installed, it just works out of the box. So whenever you come near a beacon which has an Eddystone URL frame, you will get a notification on your phone that, well, it's called Google Nearby, where it just prints the URL, you just click it and you open it. There's no app installation involved, there's nothing you need to register, no app that you need to develop and submit, it's just purely the URL, so it's very powerful. And Google actually calls this the physical web, because it's a bit problematic if you just go somewhere and for each and everything you need an app. So it's just, the web should be the new app in some cases. And that's exactly what Eddystone URL is trying to do. So in the next part, let's take a look at what those beacons actually look like and what they are sending. So I told you like what you can expect from finding those beacons, and I'll just use an Arduino board to show you really what the beacons send out, which is very interesting. So what does the Arduino look like? Actually, I'm using the Genuino or Arduino 101. It's one of the variants of the Arduino board which has integrated Bluetooth. And this of course makes it a bit easier for us, because we don't have to stick a Bluetooth module on it, we can just use it right away. So it's Intel based, but it's not really any kind of difference. Yes, so I will just show you what to do. Well, first of all, and this is what I already prepared, so I just show you the screenshots, you need to make sure that you have got support for the Intel Curie boards installed, because the Genuino 101 is based on Intel Curie chipset. And also you need to have the Curie Bluetooth LE library installed, which just provides all the functionality you need for working with the Genuino boards. So next of all, actually this one I can already show you in real life. So this is the Arduino IDE where you do all your development. Arduino just works in a very simple way. You have a setup route which is called when your app starts, and then there's a loop which is just, well, your main code which is run repeatedly. So this is where you actually put your main logic. So in the file, I just go to open an example, in this case the Curie Bluetooth LE example. In the central role, I will just open the scan example, which is doing a Bluetooth low energy scan. So I already have my board connected to my computer, so I just press the upload button, which will compile the sketch, as you can see here, and will then afterwards directly upload the compiled version of my script to the Arduino 101 that I've connected to my computer. In the meantime, well, the setup just initializes the hardware and then it starts scanning. So in the loop, this is the main place where we are. It will just check if there's a new peripheral that's found, and if it finds a new peripheral, it will just print the address of it, a local name if it has one, and the service UUIDs, and also the signal strength that we are receiving. So this is, it will just do once for each beacon that it finds. So now in the meantime, it has started compiling and is now uploading the script to my Arduino board. So you can see that it uses serial.print, so it actually prints to the serial port. So I can open in the tools menu the serial monitor so that I can actually see on my port COM7 what the app is sending out. And now I will just simulate a beacon so that you can see what I'm doing and what it works like. So for this I've got an Android phone connected where I'm transmitting the screen and where I can just turn on simulating a beacon. For example, I will just simulate the Eddystone UL beacon, and now it's turned on and you saw that immediately my app discovered the beacon. So why do I know that it's the same, that it's this Eddystone UL beacon? Because the service UUID is FEAA, and that's the service UUID that Eddystone has defined for itself. So it doesn't analyze now actually the data that's sent out, so we don't see the UL. This is something we would still need to do. But well, it's the Eddystone beacon. So if I now also turn on this iBeacon with just some random UUID and major and minor IDs, you see that it immediately discovers a second peripheral. This time it doesn't have a service UUID because the iBeacons work a bit differently. So I'll just use the iBeacon as example. How can you now actually access the data? So I won't parse it, but just show you in the Bluetooth standard what part of the Bluetooth advertisement is used for transmitting information, and then you could just get this data and parse out all those IDs that we are transmitting. And for this one, I've already prepared a short code, which I will just add to my script. So, well, let's just do it here right after printing the local name. So if I found a beacon, I will now actually also load the manufacturer data, and this is where we'll see the data from the Bluetooth beacon. So I will just go to upload again. In the meantime, I've also restarted my Arduino. What it does is actually just that it gets the manufacturer data from the Bluetooth beacon as well, stores this one in an array, and then what I'm doing here is just normal C code where I actually convert the byte array to something that we can read. So it's just a conversion to hexadecimal numbers so that we can actually see what's written inside there. And then of course in the end, I just print it to the serial port as well. So it's already finished uploading, so I will just open the serial monitor again. go back to my phone. Now I switched on the IP icon and we see this additional line here. And what you can see is actually just a long list of data. So what does it say? Most important is the 4C at the beginning, because 4C is the manufacturer ID that Apple has reserved for itself. So this is something you wouldn't be allowed to use if you create your own Bluetooth devices. If you see 4C at the beginning, you know that this is now Apple data. And then afterwards, you see that our UUID there starts with 1EFC and so on. And actually, just this data you can also see is inside of the Bluetooth advertisement. So actually, this is just this 31-byte advertisement. The Bluetooth beacon is now sending out several times per second. And you could just now sign up to Apple and check out how to actually make use of this one. So everything you see here is according to Bluetooth specifications. So this is just that in a Bluetooth advertisement, you can add some manufacturer-specific data. This is what the IP beacon is doing, and what exactly is inside of this data is up to the manufacturer. And in this case, you would read the Apple documentation to see what's happening here. Okay, so just to repeat what we've seen, I've been using the Bluetooth simulator. By the way, so the link to download it is there at the bottom. It's a free app from the Google Play Store to simulate an Edison beacon and also an IP beacon. And then I've used my Arduino 101 to just do a Bluetooth low energy scan and used it to print all the information that, or parts of the information that the sample receives. And with this one, I was already able to find out about the Edison beacon, because it has the service UUID FEHAA, which is the Edison service UUID. For the IP beacons, I had to extend the code a little bit to also print out the manufacturer data. So this was a bit of work because there's no actual example for it for the Arduino. So you can, of course, then just download the code from my blog in the new future to see this one. But you see there, for example, that 4C is the Apple manufacturer ID, and then inside of the advertisement, you see that the IP beacon UUID is actually contained in there. Okay, so that was analyzing beacons and what they actually send out using Arduino, so using embedded hardware. And as the last part, I also want to just quickly tell you about how you can develop for Bluetooth beacons using Windows 10, because, well, for Android and iOS, it's obviously well documented. There are a lot of examples. For Windows, there are not so many examples, and especially if you think about Bluetooth beacons in the corporate area, so in industry. Well, obviously, Windows is a very important platform there, so you should also know how to work with Bluetooth beacons on Windows 10. And especially because with the Windows 10 Creators Update, which was just released this month, Bluetooth finally got a lot more powerful on Windows. So there's a blog entry if you want to read more about it, linked to you at the bottom of this slide. But essentially, what's new is that up to now, Bluetooth on Windows only had one of those four possibilities, which is on the top left. So the client central role, which is essentially made for phones or PCs accessing remote sensors. So where your Windows device is the main device and the other one is the peripheral, and you just query the information from this one. So of course, that's not always the best protocol to have. And for example, well, I've been using and am still using the Microsoft Band, and well, if you've used this one with Windows mobile, Windows Phone device, notifications always haven't been really reliable. And the reason is because for a wearable, it should actually work in a different way. So then it should be so that actually the your mobile phone is the server and not the client. So the mobile phone should send out kind of a notification, a push notification to your wearable that you have received a new email, for example. And that one didn't work so far in Windows until very, very recently. So essentially, it was the other way around. So the wearable had to ask the phone, "Do you have anything new for me?" Which obviously is not the optimal way. And now, finally, with Windows 10 Creators Update, Windows can work with all the roles that are defined in the Bluetooth standard. So it's Windows can be a server for Bluetooth in the central role and also in the peripheral role. So you could also use Windows for IoT scenarios where you actually create your own wearable based on Windows 10, or where you just, well, make some low-powered sensor, for example. Well, so Bluetooth support is now, of course, in Windows 10, but it's at very hardware-oriented level. So you have got, of course, APIs to start listening for Bluetooth advertisements and for sending out information, but it doesn't really come with a pre-made implementation of beacon standards. Well, obviously, I mean, these are proprietary standards from Apple or Google standards, and also Android doesn't come with Eddystone out of the box. So there are libraries that you need to include to work with those beacon formats. And well, I just found, like when I released this one, actually when Windows 10 was released, I think quite a long time ago, I found that there was no library for Windows which allowed working with those really, really common Bluetooth beacon formats. So I just decided, well, as a developer, I just decided to create my own and make it open source so that everyone can use it, and to save you a lot of time, because then you don't have to work through all the Eddystone specification documents from Google and figure out all the bits and bytes how the Bluetooth advertisements are sent, because you saw before it's kind of just a long byte array that you get, and you have to parse it to make sense out of it. And all of this work is already done by the Bluetooth Beacon library. So it will just, well, if you just send it the Bluetooth advertisements that you get, it will just analyze them. It will manage the different beacons that it finds, so that if it has already seen the beacon before and you get the next advertisement, it will just update the one that you already have in your array, so that you just always have the latest info. And well, obviously it's fully documented, and there's a complete Windows 10 example app also under an open source license, so you can just try this one out and use this one as a base for your own app implementation. How would it actually work? Just a short example. So first step is to initialize beacon scanning. So you would just create, first of all, the beacon manager. This is a class from my Windows 10 Universal Beacon library, and then you use just normal code from the Windows APIs that you create a Bluetooth Low Energy Advertisement Watcher. You register for a callback whenever it has found a Bluetooth advertisement, and you just start the watcher. Okay? So the next step is then, of course, this callback. Whenever you got and received a Bluetooth Low Energy Advertisement, and in this case, I'm just sending this one to my Bluetooth Beacon Manager from the library, which will take care of the rest. I'm just doing this in a different thread, because this will also be shown on the user interface, so I'm just going to the UI thread in this case. And then the Bluetooth Beacon library does its magic. It will check out what kind of beacon is it, do I recognize it, for example, is it an Eddystone beacon, and then convert the information that it has to whatever it knows about it. So the basic information you can get for every Bluetooth beacon, so you will know the Bluetooth address and the beacon type, and then depending on which one it is, you can just directly get out the data. So for example, if the Bluetooth library identified it as a Eddystone URL frame, you can just cast the frame to URL Eddystone frame, and just with one property directly access the URL. URL is really encoded in a very clever way to make it as short as possible. So for example, this HTTP semicolon slash slash www dot and so on is encoded into a single byte. Well, remember you only have 31 bytes, so it's anyway limiting the URL a lot, so you don't want to waste those valuable bytes with HTTP as a text. So there's a lot of optimization going on, and the Bluetooth Beacon library can read all this encoded data and just make a string out of it, the direct URL that's actually meant by the Bluetooth Beacon. And then of course it's up to you what you want to do. So that's your creativity, but you don't have to worry about the basic beacon stuff. If you have any kind of Windows 10 device, you can try it out. Just go to the Windows Store. There's this Windows 10 example app. It's called Bluetooth Beacon Interactor. I said it's open source and free, and because it's just a normal Windows 10 UWP app, it actually works on every Windows 10 device that has Bluetooth Low Energy support. So you can run it on a phone, you can run it on your PC, and you can even run it on the HoloLens. So the HoloLens also has Bluetooth Low Energy support, and actually it was quite nice experience. So I had my app already in the store, and well, then at one day I just got an email from Microsoft, well, you're now holographic developer, congratulations, your app is now listed also for the HoloLens. So because it's 100% compatible, it's the same binary, it just also works out of the box on the HoloLens. You can see now I'm just using it there in the room and scanning for beacons, and it found an Eddystone beacon in there. And you can see it has 25 degrees Celsius, for example. Well, last question that you maybe have is, okay, those Bluetooth beacons are really cool, where can I get those? Of course, there are many different options. It's just those two companies have been around since the beginning and are very popular because they produce very nice looking beacons and also very developer friendly beacons. So both of those beacon manufacturers have got APIs where you can easily configure the beacons, change, for example, the URL that's sent out by Eddystone. And this makes it really, really good for starting your development efforts. So it starts at around $60 for 3 pieces. It's minimum you need to order. And then of course, for a real deployment scenario, you need a lot more. You can still go with those beacons. Of course, you can then just order really, really, really cheap beacons as well and order thousands of them. It's really up to you, but for getting started, those two beacons are really nice for developers. So that's it. Hope it was useful for you to learn a bit more about Bluetooth beacons. I'm Andreas Jackel. If you enjoyed the session, just follow me on Twitter, visit my blog. Twitter is Andy Jackel, my blog is andreasjackel.com. Would be happy to hear from you if you liked the overview presentation, and if you have any ideas or suggestions, please just let me know. And otherwise, just good luck with your own Bluetooth beacon apps, and well, let's see what will happen and what cool ideas you can come up with. Thank you.